Mayor Paul TenHaken, thanks for having us back in your office.
It's a
spring day today.
Thanks for having me back. Yeah. A few things have changed since you've been here. I got some new art on the wall and some...
Tell me about that.
That's actually a piece from Chuck Bennis.
Okay.
He's an artist in Brookings. Yeah. And what I don't tell people is that's a seal in the armory in Brookings that he did. But it's like, why do you have a Brookings piece in your office? Because I think it's cool. Looks kind of governmental. So I just got that a couple weeks ago from Chuck. Yeah. So, yeah.
I like that. Let's talk about some of the big issues that the public wants to know about. And one is a potential softening of the economy, maybe even a recession. The expectation that Sioux Falls will always be recession-proof to a certain extent. How are you fielding some of those questions right now?
Yeah, well, certainly not true that we're always recession-proof, and was really highlighted in the last 6 months when we had to adjust our budget tremendously for a bridge project in this community, that we had budgeted 10, 11 million bucks for a bridge here at 6th Street downtown. We got one bid and it was almost double that. And it made us kind of step back and say, okay, we're in a different place right now with materials, with inflationary costs, with labor. And so that was an eye-opener for us. We've actually had to turn down several project bids over the last 6 months of, we just had to reject all the bids because they're too much money. We can't pay for some of the work that needs to be done in the city. And so we're not immune from that, just like the average homeowner is looking at, or the average resident is saying, we can't afford this right now. It's too much. This has cost too much. New vehicle is too much, whatever it is. So I'm certainly seeing a change in the economy. Our sales tax has softened a little bit even in the last several months. We've been on fire the last couple years. Multifamily permits have slowed down this year already. Single family housing permits have slowed down dramatically. Not a lot of just spec homes being built. So we're seeing that, we're noticing that, and I think that just requires us to be very cautious in like how we're spending taxpayer dollars, what we're keeping in our reserves as a city for whatever the next 6, 12, 18 months could bring.
How do you feel the sales tax reduction from the state legislature will impact the Sioux Falls economy in particular?
Well, the sales tax reduction that the legislature approved, the governor signed, you know, going from 4.5 to 4.2, our 2 cents that we collect as a city will still remain, so it doesn't affect that. But what it does do is it takes a little more than $100 million out of the state coffers. So when we have projects that we may need financial assistance from the state with, there's less money. And I'd be lying if I said I wasn't a little concerned, because I hate taxes. I think we all hate taxes. But we're also growing at a record pace in this community and really across the state. So people want us to do more. They're expecting more. There's more people that need more services. And at the same time, they want to pay less and less to the government to provide those services. So that's just this tension that always exists. And I wish we could cut all taxes. But at the end of the day, we need cops. We need potholes that have to be filled. I mean, we need bridges that have to get constructed in a really difficult financial economy. We'll see how it goes over the next year or two. But I think my biggest concern on that whole thing would be, I want to protect our 2 cents that we collect here, because without that, I mean, if that would get touched or if that would get broken into in some way, we'd have some very hard decisions here in Sioux Falls that we'd have to make.
Yeah. You've been through an Amazon warehouse, a meat processing plant. These are complicated, big projects. What are some of the projects you're looking forward to in the city, kind of navigating that next big thing, where the workers will come from, where they'll live, how that will impact and change the culture of a city? What's on the horizon?
Well, a few things on the horizon. You mentioned Amazon. Amazon is opening, and they've been open now for probably 6 months or so. They probably only have about a third of their workers out there. So workforce continues to be one of the top two or three issues that companies are dealing with, whether you're a dry cleaning place like across the street here or you're in Amazon, finding people and finding workers specifically in that $18 to $25, $26 an hour range. Those are hard jobs to fill right now, due largely to a couple factors. One was being childcare, and a whole different topic we could, I'm sure, spend a lot of time talking about. So workforce continues to be the issue that when businesses are looking to come here, it's the first question they ask. What's your unemployment rate? How big does your MSA draw from? Where can we get employees from? But what we're seeing right now is there's just a lot of, let's just sit back and wait in this economy. For instance, we got a parking ramp with a great opportunity sitting on top of it for a developer to come in and build, go up, you know, build on the side, getting a lot of interest, a lot of people asking us about it, but we haven't seen a formal proposal yet, and we haven't seen that because you'd have to be pretty risky in this environment right now to want to tackle a project of that size and of that magnitude. So it's my thought that this year in 2023, we're not going to see these massive announcements of a Wholestone or an Amazon or a CJ Foods or whatnot like we've seen the last couple of years. There's going to be a little bit of a, hey, let's just see what this economy does over the next 12 to 24 months.
I don't have skin in the game from being a developer or having a lot of money to invest. I'm just a regular person who lives in this city. And that doesn't sound so terrible to me because sometimes it feels like we're growing pretty fast. What are you hearing from regular people about loving the city that they live in and adjusting to the growth a little bit, but also wanting to grow? I mean, this is a city that wants to expand, be more urban, but also kind of, a lot of us come from rural South Dakota, rural Southwest Minnesota, rural Northwest Iowa. They sort of want it to stay.
Yeah, great. It's a great question. And it's a tension that exists almost every day where you have people who say, sick of all the growth, how about we take care of the roads first, Mayor? How about we And so the way you make a city stop growing, there's really kind of two ways. One is you have an economy that kind of leads to a slowdown in growth, which I think we'll see a little bit of that this year. The second way is you make a city that no one wants to come to, that has high crime, that's expensive, where housing is unaffordable, where the schools are terrible. And so obviously we don't want to do that. So it's like, yeah, we can stop growth. Let's just start ruining this city. And you've seen cities across this country that have had a big decline in population this last year. And if you point to some of them, you can look at some specific things they've done policy-wise and whatnot that have driven people out of those communities because they no longer feel safe, they don't like the schools, whatnot. So I agree with you that a year to maybe catch our breath and just say, okay, let's just catch up from the last couple of years of record-breaking growth is not the worst thing in the world. And I hope no one interprets that as Paul's an anti-growth mayor. I'm not. But I came from the private sector, and I remember one year in my company, we were growing double digits every year, and we set a goal for the next year just to be 0%. I said, I just want to be flat because we got to make sure that this car that's been running 90 miles an hour has the right maintenance done to it before we try and jack it up to 100 miles an hour.
Yeah. Let's talk about a sustainable Sioux Falls, because this is something that has been important to a lot of people, especially young people who live in Sioux Falls and new residents who want a city in the future, especially, that they can be proud of from a climate action standpoint, from a sustainability standpoint, from a green spaces standpoint, from clean air and clean water. Contextually, a sustainability plan is important to you. Tell me a little bit about why.
Yeah, it's very important. And it's important for some of the reasons you just mentioned, in that our young people in our community and those looking to move here, they want to look at, does this community prioritize sustainable building practices, sustainable water practices with the river which runs through our community? That's important to the next generation. And I very much realize that. And so we've done a lot of things over the last couple years in Sioux Falls, 10 years or so, whether that's the landfill gas that we harvest and we pump to Poet and they run a whole ethanol plant off it, to no-mow zones along the river to prevent the runoff, the non-source point water funds that we're putting into the river. We have some low-impact development we've been piloting. We're the first city in the state that's added an EV to our fleet to start testing what an EV vehicle on our health department could look like. So we're doing a lot of these things already. I think when you talk about sustainability, you have to strike a balance. It's like anything. Whether that's policing, whether that's sustainability, whether that's education, when the pendulum swings too far one way or the other, you have upset people. And so my 5 years in this office has been one of trying to hit the ball down the center of the fairway, right? And so we rolled out a sustainability draft plan about a year and a half ago. And after doing that, realized there were some important voices that weren't at the table that helped draft it, including almost all of our energy companies weren't involved in that plan. Energy is a big part of sustainability. We talk about emissions, carbon emissions, greenhouse gases. We also didn't have any of our home builders, our development community, which when you look at building homes, green building practices, solar, they need to be at the table, which is why we took a step back and said, hey, we need to make sure these voices are part of this, retooled some areas of the plan, and have kind of relaunched that, making sure that those other voices have had a say for the issues that they have a stake in as builders, as energy companies, and so forth.
So your office received an open letter from some of the stakeholders and the people who were involved in the 30-person steering committee and said the new plan is worse than no plan at all because it's taken out all the teeth, the word climate change have been removed, the goals, the actionable goals have been removed. What's your response to that?
Well, my response is it's largely not true. The plan is still very much the same plan, but the truth of the matter is in this environment we're in, this political environment, certain words are very triggering to certain groups. The word climate change shouldn't be polarizing, but over the past 10 years, that's become a politically charged word. Greenhouse gases. If I say, Lori, you're a great patriot because you served in the military, patriot has a certain vernacular. If I say, Lori, you're a very progressive leader at Public Broadcasting, that has vernacular. So what we've tried to do is soften some of those words that have triggered both sides. The plan is still very much the same. We're just using terms and phrases that aren't as polarizing in the community. So to say that this plan is better than no plan at all, I think is a kind of a slap in the face to all the work that's been done, all our team does and continues to do on sustainability. Truth of the matter is we're doing more on this topic than any city in this state right now. So we're already leading and we'll continue to lead, but we also have to realize there's a lot of opinions on this topic and what we call special interest groups. And they are special interest groups because they have kind of a singular focus and a singular interest. It's my job as the mayor to make sure that all interests are represented when we have a plan like this that we roll out.
How do you lead as a political leader, as a mayor? And you have a strong communications background. Without letting climate deniers and science skeptics have their way. Facts are facts about climate change.
When we rolled out this draft plan a year ago, you talk about this, the current green special interest group that's mad. I should show you some of the emails I got when we rolled out the draft plan a year ago. They were even worse from the climate deniers who say, this is a farce, Paul's buying into the Green New Deal, none of this stuff exists. Those are real opinions in this community. And I have to respect that. Do I have to agree with them? No. But I have to know that there's a lot of people in our communities who have a wide array of opinions on a lot of issues. So my job as a mayor is to, again, back to that down the center of the fairway thing, say, what are we doing? We'll keep doing stuff and keep pushing, but we also have to realize there's people in this community who also have very different opinions that want to see us push in the exact opposite direction. So how you get to yes on something like that is you make sure you have a big table. We didn't have a big table initially. We made the table bigger, so we had all these voices at the table, and that's what's led to where we're at today, which I feel is a very great and pragmatic plan that we'll be hopefully implementing.
So a big table, but not false equivalency.
Big time. And I'm not a climate denier. I mean, look at some of the weather patterns we've had. Look at all the weather events I've had to deal with in 5 years in this office. Our climate is changing, and to deny that in any way is really ignoring what's happening around the world and what's happening with the science of our climate. There's no denying that. There is, however, different ways that you respond to that. If I was the mayor of Miami and knew that 3 more inches in sea rise would flood my downtown, be a very different approach we'd be taking than when I'm in Sioux Falls, South Dakota, and have an ag community where the river is very important and letting their cattle graze in the river is very important. They have very different philosophies than you maybe find in different parts of the country.
So take away all the input and the emails and the letters that you get and think about you and your family in 2050. One plan had net zero emissions, 2050, this plan is a little bit less specific about what some of those goals might be. I think that's fair to say.
Yeah.
What do you want your kids to think about Dad's time in the mayor's office from a sustainable standpoint? What's the best thing that can come out of the current plan that you're going with? And then what's the worst case scenario with the current plan? You know, I'm going to ask you that next. But
so the reality, Lori, when you talk about climate in our environment, is the majority of the change that's going to happen in this world around climate has to happen in Asia, has to happen in India, and has to happen in South America. When you look at where the emissions are coming from. So we need to just do our part in Sioux Falls. We need to do our part to preserve what we can here, our river, our grasslands, our low impact development projects, to preserve those things that we can do here. Take a pragmatic approach. I hope my legacy on that would be in 2050, like the mayor of Sioux Falls at that time, Mayor TenHaken, he kicked off the sustainability discussion in Sioux Falls. It's the first time we're ever really talking about this to this level. And he did it in a big table fashion. I hope that's what people would say. The worst case scenario would be if Sioux Falls, South Dakota, is responsible for the big fireball that eventually hits the earth because we weren't aggressive enough. I don't think that's going to happen. And so I'm very comfortable and actually very proud of where we're landing on this thing. And I'm confident our city council will support it when we ultimately ask for them to adopt it.
What else are your kids learning? How many kids do you have?
I have three kids.
Three, that's what I thought. What else are they learning about leadership from your time? What do you take home? What do you not leave at the office?
You know what? They're learning about the joys and sorrows of public service, mm-hmm. and that they know when I come home and I'm rubbing my forehead, they don't even have to ask. They know it was a tough meeting or a tough day. What I'm trying not to do, and it's very easy to do at times, is come home and speak ill of someone, speak ill of an issue, throw someone under the bus, because it's a frustrating job. And I don't want to come home at the end of the day and have them see service as just something that's god-awful that they should never do because look how hard it was for my old man. I want them to be inspired by it and say, man, my dad made some change in our community. He was always happy. He was always friendly to people. I want to be able to do that someday. Am I doing a good job of that? I don't think so. But that's what I'm aspiring to do when I see them at 5:30, 6 o'clock every day when I come home.
Yeah. One more question, and that is the Inflation Reduction Act. The state of South Dakota passed on the opportunity to get some federal money to reduce emissions. Rapid City is applying, taking the federal government up on that. Your office is deciding fairly shortly.
Yeah, there's
running
up against there's a deadline.
Yeah.
And a shot clock on that. So what we're looking at on that is, like all federal dollars, what are the strings? Free money is never free money. What are the expectations? What are we supposed to do with these dollars? The initial grant is just a planning grant. The challenge we always have in Sioux Falls is, and the example I sometimes use is, we're the Yankees. And if you're on the Yankees, you love the Yankees. If you're not, you hate the Yankees. So is Sioux Falls the right organization to be accepting this grant, or is there a regional player? Sioux Metro Growth Alliance, the Southeastern Development Council, which represents the government agencies in Southeast South Dakota, that can accept this so that it's more of a regional approach, because our transportation connections between T and Harrisburg and Hartford and so forth, we have to start thinking about those things. So will they want to partner with us if it's a Sioux Falls grant, or if it's a more regional grant? It makes a little more sense. So that's what we're looking at right now, is should we be the group that accepts that, or is there a better place for this to fit within the state?
Mayor Paul TenHaken, always a pleasure to sit down with you. Thank you so much for giving us so much time.
Thank you, Lori. Appreciate you.